But so he sent me this painting, and I looked over it, and I thought, wow, this is interesting. It's got some interesting stuff in it. The painting is by this fellow here, Jules Tavernier. And Tavernier was a French painter, born in 1844. His mother was French, his father was British. He wanted to attend the École des Beaux-Arts, or the French School of Fine Arts. He was in wars, and he felt patriotic, so he enlisted and served as a field artist during the war. In 1871, he moved to London, worked as an illustrator, and then moved to the United States, where he worked in New York for Harper's Weekly. In 1873, Harper's Weekly liked his work so much that they paired him up with Paul Franzini and sent them on a quest across the United States to paint the Old West while it was still there, the New West, the New World. And they basically went on horseback all the way across the plains. They traveled through Kansas, Colorado, Texas, Wyoming. They came back east along the Oregon Trail to Nebraska, and then north to the Red Cloud Agency. And he painted a lot of scenes, Native American scenes, in that part of the plains, Pine Ridge, Crow Butte, Chimney Rock. While at the Crow Agency, this is the guy right. In fact, this is a picture of him at the Crow Agency. While there, he was actually invited by the Native Americans to paint the Sundance Ceremony. And as far as we know, this is the first time any non-Indians even been to one, much less painted one. And he did a lot of paintings of Plains Indians, Native American customs. This particular painting, which actually on this screen, that's about the size of this painting in reality, just recently sold at auction for $63,000. This is the Sundance Ceremony painting that he did. You see the Indian men here that are tied to the pole. Very prolific in Native American art, but especially in the plains and the southwest area. Eventually, he moved to San Francisco, where he spent 10 years painting California images. He also worked on his sketches that he had done in the plains and finished those paintings. This is actually a painting that he did of the landscape around Petaluma. He joined the newly formed Bohemian Club in San Francisco, and from everything I've read about this man, he was quite the drinker and was probably the most bohemian of the Bohemian Club members at the time. He also wasn't very good at paying his bills. So he ended up traveling away from San Francisco when he burned bridges. He ended up in Monterey, where he actually started the Carmel Artist Colony. And this is a picture of him leaning up against the Monterey, the adobe, the old Monterey jail. It's a picture of the Carmel Mission that he painted. I get this email wondering if I can identify some of the activities in this painting that the Wildenstein Gallery in New York had purchased at auction. It was an auction that took place in Geneva. And he asked if I thought it was a formal ceremony. So I started looking at it. I looked at the costuming, the dance house structure, anything I could. This guy here is kind of hard to see. He's actually smoking a pipe. Pomo pipes didn't have stems and a bowl out here. Pomo pipes were a straight shot with the bowl up here. So you smoked it upright like that. And that was one of the hints I had, and the costuming was right. And the researcher in New York had discovered that it was commissioned by a San Francisco by the name of Tiburcio Parrott, which painted between 1876 and 1878. He thought the subject of the painting was a Lake County ceremony. He didn't know for sure. I inspected the painting, looked at the clothing, looked at everything, and then a close inspection of the doorway to the dance house is what really cinched it for me. That is Mount Canocti in the unmistakable outline of Mount Canocti. So it was like, okay, not only do I know it was a formal ceremony, I know the reservation it took place on. He lived. That's the only place where you have that view of Mount Canocti.
Wow.
And he captured it. Yeah, and he put it right there in the painting. So who is this Tiburcio Parrott? Well, he's the son of this guy, John Parrott, who was a U.S. consul in Mazatlan, Mexico, and moved to San Francisco in 1850, owned blocks of land in San Francisco, built buildings, including historic landmark number 89, the granite block. And he and his wife had seven children, including Tiburcio. So John Parrott was a fairly wealthy San Francisco gentleman at this time. In 1873, the defunct California Borax Company wanted to get rid of Sulphur Bank Mine. So it was acquired by Tiburcio and his father, William Badcock, Darius Mills, to excavate some quicksilver. These are 1906 photographs showing Elam Indian Colony out here and Sulphur Bank Mine. So he was familiar with the Elam Indian Colony. He made many trips to Sulphur Bank Mine because he was running this business now. And so he commissioned this French artist to paint this ceremony at the Elam Indian Colony. Tavernier made several trips to Sulphur Bank. In fact, we have a newspaper article from 1878 that says, Tavernier has just returned from Sulphur Springs, where he's been taking some sketches for the completion of his masterpiece, the Indian Sweat House, purchased by Tiburcio Parrott. As I said, he had some drinking problems. By the 1880s, he had run up enough debts and pissed off enough people in high society in San Francisco that it was time for him to move. So in 1884, he moved to Hawaii. He loved painting volcano scenes. And he started the whole volcano school of painting. In fact, this painting here is 12 feet high and 90 feet long. It was meant to be in a round circle, so the person viewing it stood in the center and looked at it like you're standing in the middle of the caldera. Unfortunately, due to his drinking, his wife left him in 1887, and he died of a drinking-related illness in 1889 at the age of 44. So, a short-lived fellow, but very prolific as a painter. His pieces are on display at all of these different Lake County History again with his painting. I started digging into the history of this guy, Parrott. It turns out, in the 1880s, there was an addition made to the California Constitution saying that it was against the law to hire Chinese or Mongolian people. Well, he was hiring Chinese people to work in Sulphur Bank Mine, at least 200 of them. And mines all over the county had Chinese communities that were living with those mines and working in those mines. And Tiburcio openly denounced persecution of Chinese and refused to fire his employees at Sulphur Bank. Well, in 1880, he was forced to fire his Chinese. He was arrested, imprisoned, and they were threatening to hang him for hiring Chinese people at Sulphur Bank Mine. Yeah. So he got some lawyers together, filed a writ of habeas corpus, claiming that the new law violated the 14th Amendment and also the Burlingame Treaty that the United States had with China at the time. And the Burlingame Treaty stated that the Chinese subjects residing in the United States were to be treated with the exact same courtesy as anyone else living in the United States. Ninth Circuit Court rendered its opinion in favor of his position, determined that the state did not have the power to forbid employment of anyone. And Parrott was promptly released from prison and immediately rehired his Chinese workers.
Good.
So, 1878, ceremony, ritual, tribute, the American. Just the center pole, that's all.
Just the center pole.
Yeah. Yep.
John, was that only the Ilim tribe, or were there other tribes there?
The Ilim community was one of three southeastern Pomo tribes, and then there were also, there were about 30 different major villages around the lake. Ilim, and the southeastern Pomo, the eastern Pomo had 1, 2, 3, 4. About 6 or 7 different tribes. There were about 8 or 10 tribes around the lake.